The Khmer Empire ruled over most of Southeast Asia for 600 years, making it one of history's largest and most powerful civilizations. But in the 10th century, the king Jayavarman IV uprooted the capital from its established base in Angkor and moved it 80 miles away to this remote jungle location, building a massive city of palaces and temples called Gakhae. Yet, only 20 years later, under the rule of Jayavarman's son, Harshavarman, the city mysteriously collapsed, and its secrets are only now being revealed.
And so who is this?
Varuna.
Varuna.
Yeah.
So this is the god of the West.
Yeah.
This is here because this entrance faces to the West.
Yeah.
In addition to being the god of the West, Varuna was also the god of water. In Gakhae, a city without a substantial water source, Varuna was likely the god whose favor King Jayavarman and his son wanted most.
That's a foot from a statue. This is unbelievable. Okay, let's see if we can reveal a bit more of it.
We carefully brush away more dirt from the foot to get a better look.
Small, very small, huh?
Very small. When I see this foot, it reminds me of a story we heard from the former looters, that they took out a father and son statue from here. And the father maybe is Jayavarman IV, and the son could be Harshavarman II. That statue's never been recovered.
While the foot of a missing statue might not seem important, to Brad, this is forensic gold. If the stolen statue surfaces in a museum or private collection, the foot will interlock, providing critical evidence to repatriate the statue to Cambodia.
You have a pin.
You have a pin.
You have to move the pin.
From a statue?
Yeah.
Panit brings over a block that they've found nearby, known as a pin.
So these pins basically go into the ground to stabilize the pedestal under the statue.
Yes.
Could this be with this?
Let's try it.
If they were paired in antiquity, the statue and pin should slot together like an ancient Lego.
Look at that.
It fits?
Yeah.
That locks in there?
Yeah.
This goes together?
Yeah.
And we see, this is unbelievable. And we can see here, there would have been another foot here.
Brad suspects that somewhere in a museum or private collection is a broken statue whose feet we have just recovered. And now for some archaeological police work. Scanning the find with an Artec Leo. This device takes millions of laser accurate measurements and stitches them together to form a three-dimensional image. Think of it as a virtual fingerprint, or in this case, footprint, that can one day match to a priceless work and bring it home to Cambodia. Once the scan is finished, we get back to digging.
Oh, Josh, I found something.
Found something? Oh, sandstone.
Yeah, sandstone.
It's got a little lip.
Yeah, very smooth.
Yeah.
I think that it should be the part of the pedestal.
You think it's part of a pedestal?
Yeah.
Oh, because it's so fine?
Yeah, so fine.
There's no other pieces to it, though, which is frustrating.
Josh, you might think I'm crazy, but I would bet you that's Skanda and Shiva's pedestal.
Really?
The one we saw in the museum.
Okay, hold the phone. Brad thinks this was part of the Skanda and Shiva, the stolen statue that was put on the black market for $25 million by art dealer Douglas Latchford before it was recovered and brought to the National Museum. Unquestionably, the greatest piece of art ever found from Gakhae.
The pedestal is very smooth and it has no flower design. It looks just like that. It's also in the perfect location in terms of what we heard from the looters about bringing Skanda and Shiva out of the chamber.
Right, that statue was found here.
Right behind you.
It's not far.
Right.
It's on the way. And wow.
Look, I've been looking at photos for years of that statue. I recognize it.
You think that's from that statue?
That's Skanda and Shiva.
Oh, wow. You see?
This would be like this. This is the pedestal. If this is part of that sculpture, it would be the largest missing piece of it. The rest of it is almost entirely there.
Yes.
Okay.
Back to Phnom Penh.
Back to Phnom Penh.
If there's even a chance that we have a piece of the Skanda and Shiva, there's no time to waste. So So we rush back to the National Museum in Phnom Penh to assess the find.
Okay, moment of truth.
The Skanda and Shiva waits in the restoration lab with Chaya Sochet, the head of conservation at the museum. Now, it's time to see if our fragment was once part of this iconic statue.
We have brought you a present.
Ah.
Which we hope is a part of this.
Okay, yes, I will try.
So, let's see what we've got. So this banding does look almost exactly like this.
We attempt to match the piece to some damaged stone in the front of the pedestal.
Or here? No.
No. I want to try another part.
In the back?
Okay. Yes.
Right. Oh, okay. This is more damaged here.
So, Josh, look at this.
Yes.
This band here is,
right.
is yes. identical.
The same.
It is. Yes. It's almost the same depth yes. from the top of the pedestal, right?
Yes.
Corner, maybe?
No, because that...
Right, it's too wide here.
Yes.
Let's see if we move it down the line, if it fits in. No?
No.
Wow, look
it fits.
At that. Perfect match.
Yes, great.
Just interlocked into place. Did you hear that? That's great. Exactly where it fits. Look at that.
Yes.
It is great. Absolutely perfect. You can see exactly where it chipped off right here. That is insane.
No gap. Perfect
A match. Perfect fit.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Congratulations. Just being in the presence of the statue again, I'm reminded what a spectacular piece of art this is.
It's like we found a corner of a Picasso painting and walked into one of the greatest museums in the world and fitted it perfectly.
Right. That's the thing I keep thinking is that this isn't just a statue. It is a masterpiece.
Yeah, absolutely.
This will be reattached?
Yes, absolutely.
And this will eventually go on display to the public?
Yes, this yeah. will go on display.
I look forward to coming back and seeing it in the museum.
Thank you, Josh.
Thank you, Brad. All the best.
Akun.
Thank you.
This is an incredible win, one which brings this statue closer to full restoration. And while we celebrate, we get more good news. The inscription we unearthed in Prasat Krachop's entry has been translated. It turns out to be a list of 17 people, a list that helps us better understand the population of Koh Ker 1,000 years ago. For Cambodians, both then and now, the Koh Ker statues possess spirits, and we've just helped to heal the Skanda and Shiva. To honor the mending of this national treasure, a group of Buddhist monks has invited me and the museum team to participate in a ceremony of thanks and prayer. Koh Ker has been in ruins for centuries, but despite the ravages of both time and crime, it feels to me that at its heart, this place is very much alive. The remarkable finds here prove that the city was born from the boundless ambition of a king who needed to make his own mark. And what a mark it was. He inspired massive monuments and created a center of great art and beauty. High-tech scans have revealed that the fall of his capital may well have been the result of a 1-2 punch. The catastrophic failure of a dam, which robbed the city of water, coupled with clues carved in stone that an ambitious relative seized his moment to take control. Today, proud Cambodians are rediscovering this ancient heritage one block at a time, and former thieves are guiding us to new places to look, below both water and soil. And a tireless advocate seeks justice by bringing looted artifacts back to where they belong. In fact, not long after our dig came a major announcement. Brad and his team have negotiated the return of art dealer Douglas Latchford's entire collection of Cambodian art. A brilliant victory in the fight to restore Koh Ker to glory and to inspire all those who make the effort to reach this once forgotten capital.